And number 14 is Neil Adams, one of the most legendary artists the entire comic book industry has ever known. This guy revolutionized comic book art in the 70s. His unbelievably realistic shading combined with some really dynamic and fluid art really influenced hundreds of artists the world over into duplicating his style. This guy is most famous for his work on Green Arrow, Green Lantern, Batman, Deadman, and of course, the Uncanny X-Men. Neil Adams, I don't think he needs any introduction. I don't think I need to tell anybody who he is. This guy made comic books look the way they are today. I remember picking up a Batman comic from the 70s and opening it up and not even believing that it was from the 70s because it was so realistic looking. Like, his artwork was so realistic for the time period that it was made in. And that's what really, and his Batman is probably one of the most famous. His Batman basically deviated from the extremely campy Dick Sprang Batman that most people were familiar with. I mean, he made Batman really, he made Batman dark. He made Batman look the way he does today, with the longer ears and the darker costume, the blacker costume, and it looks a lot more menacing and scary. This guy is awesome, and he made comic books awesome. And number 13 on this list is another controversial artist, Todd McFarlane. Yes. Now, I know a lot of you are probably not very happy with this decision, but I realize that Todd McFarlane has pretty much grown into a Class A D-bag. But there's one thing has not changed about this guy. His artwork is still beautiful to look at. When he started out in the 80s, when he was doing like Batman and when he was doing artwork for Batman and stuff, a lot of people started to realize that he had potential, so he went on to do drawing and artwork for Spider-Man, and that's when he became really successful. McFarlane was another one of these artists and creators who in the 90s became extremely popular and wealthy and famous because of his unbelievably high-selling Spider-Man issues that he drew. And just like Jim Lee and Rob Liefeld, you know, all these guys who became uber successful, they pretty much broke off from, all of them pretty much broke off from Marvel and they went on to do their own thing. McFarlane and Liefeld went on to create Image. Jim Lee created like the Wildstorm universe along with Wildcats. And pretty much, Todd McFarlane, he would go on to create one of the most famous non-Marvel DC characters, Spawn. And whatever you want to say about the guy, he knew how to draw. Number 11 is the late Dick Giordano. Truly one of the greatest DC artists who ever lived. Dick Giordano, who literally, he took all the established characters and made them all look great. He made Batman and Superman appear to be extremely graceful and muscular. He made Green Arrow go into a sort of... He made Green Arrow look cool. He made everyone look cool. He especially made Wonder Woman look beautiful and graceful and absolutely elegant like she should be. Dick Giordano was the man with the plan who made all of the great comic book characters look the way they were supposed to. And he's influenced dozens of other artists over the years because of his contributions. And it's such a shame that he's dead, because even some of his more recent art is absolutely beautiful to look at. With age, he's learned to better draw off, you know, even more detailed and complex facial expressions and muscle tone, which is something that he always knew how to draw, was extremely well-carved muscles and poses for his characters. His art just felt real, and it felt alive. And it sucks that he's dead now, because I would have wanted to see what other amazing stuff he would have done if he were still alive. But unfortunately, I guess we're just gonna have to live with the stuff he's given us now. And he has given us a lot. So, all I can say is, Dick Giordano, rest in peace. You've earned it. Alright, number 10 on my list, I am proudly able to present to you Kevin Maguire. I don't think any other artist deserves the number 10 spot on my list other than Kevin Maguire. This guy is simply one of the best artists ever, at least in recent years. I'll tell you about this guy. Nobody can draw facial expressions better than Kevin Maguire. It simply can't be done. This guy draws the most realistic and genuinely human facial expressions ever. It's like he looks at a photo and then he just draws it or something. I don't know. This guy's like knowledge of the human face, like knowledge of the eyes, the nose, the lips, the mouth, everything. This guy can draw it perfectly. That's not to say he's not good at drawing muscles or anything. Look at that Iceman right there. That's an amazing job. Kevin Maguire, he's simply an amazing artist. He's one of the best ever, and I find him to be underrated as well. Like, not a lot of people know about him, which is a damn shame, because, like, he's truly a talented artist, and he needs to be doing way more books. Like, I want to pick up some more books with Kevin Maguire art in them. But another thing that makes him such a great artist is simply the poses he puts his characters in, and also the shading. He's extremely good at shading as well, and of course just adding a whole bunch of presence to his characters. Great artist. And number 9 on the list is Gene Colan. Yes, without a doubt, one of the all-time great comic book artists. And why do I say this? Well, take one good look at this Iron Man cover. Just look at it. It's one of the greatest comic book covers I've ever seen in my life. This guy, he could make an absolutely amazing, stunning comic book cover. That's not to say he wasn't good at drawing actual pages, but I'm just saying that nearly every cover he has done is completely memorable in its own unique way. The thing that makes this guy so great is just how he draws his the muscles, the tightness of the muscles, and the shading. The shading on his drawings is absolutely phenomenal. He drew several issues of Doctor Strange and like Daredevil and Iron Man and characters like that, as well as Batman and a few other DC characters. He's another guy who switched a lot back and forth between Marvel and DC. He even did the artwork for the Spectre in 1987. Although I regret to say I haven't found an image of his Spectre drawing, but I'm sure it's phenomenal. Gene Colan could create such a triumphant presence, an atmosphere with his drawings. And he did that with the use of amazing geometry, shadings, and just overall crazy ass. And number 8 is Ethan Van Siver. Without a doubt, one of the most underrated and most talented artists of all time. Van Siver is undoubtedly one of the greatest modern artists who has ever lived. Because this man, there are many artists who excel at one aspect of drawing, whether it be shading, muscles, facial expressions. This guy, he perfects everything. It doesn't matter what aspect of his drawings he does, whether it's faces, whether it's muscles, whether it's proportions, whether it's shading, whether it's, solidity, he gets everything right. And because of that, his artwork always turns out gorgeous. I mean, look at Barry Allen. Everything about this drawing is perfect. And I mean, and he currently works alongside Jeff Johns. And of course, a great storyteller like Jeff Johns needs an equally great artist to bring his story to life. And there's nobody else who I think could be qualified other than Ethan Van Siver. And without a doubt, my favorite piece of artwork by him is this. Just look at it. This is one of the most beautiful pieces of comic book art. All four human Green Lanterns plus Kilowog all standing perfectly side by side in frame, holding their rings up. It's pure, regular, modern art. And it's amazing. And that's why this guy is awesome. And the next person is John Romita Sr. Yup, you gotta have the Romitas in here. What can I say about this guy that hasn't already been said? John Romita Sr. is another one of the great artists who made comic books important. He is definitely one of the most important comic book artists who ever lived. As he not only drew for Spider-Man, but he drew, in fact, many people consider him to be the definitive Spider-Man artist. And he's definitely my third favorite Spider-Man artist. Of course, my first being Mark Bagley, and my second favorite you'll see later on in the list. But yeah, John Romita, he's definitely an important artist to the Wall Crawler. As he really brought out, he gave us so many iconic comic book covers and comic book panels, it's not even funny. So I feel that he deserves a whole lot of credit. He deserves more credit than some, even. This guy has done just about as much for the comic book world as the people he's worked with, such as Stan Lee or even the mighty Jack Kirby. John Romita. Next on the list is John Romita Jr. Yes, the son of John Romita, obviously. And he, just like his father, has left an incredibly deep impression on the world of comic books. He has given us many a great artwork. I've heard people complain for different reasons about John Romita Jr.'s artwork, that it's a bit like his characters just don't look a bit too cartoony or anything like that. In my opinion, that works to his advantage because as the way he draws his characters, it complements the stories that are being told. Because when his characters show emotion, when they show like rawness or grittiness, it really shows up through the artwork. And that's why I think he's a great artist, is because he's able to bring a gritty and dark and really atmospheric type of tone to any comic book he works on. And in my opinion, he's just as good of a drawer as his father. Although, like, his drawings look nothing like his father's, I don't think they really have to. I think that they stand out incredibly well enough on their own. And the fact that this guy is still working in comics today, that really, he does say a whole lot. I think that the Romitas have served the comic book industry very well, and I hope they continue to do so. I know it's a bit of a cheat having both the Romitas on here, but you know what? It's my list, so live with it.